Got to get up here and get my mic turned on. Let's come on, church. Let's give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. The Bible said, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. If you're breathing this morning, I want you to stand to your feet. Come on, let's give him a shout of praise. Let's let him know we're happy to be in the house this morning. Amen. Love on him. Praise God. You guys look great. Praise the Lord. So happy you're here this morning. You can be seated for a few minutes if you'd like. You get a lot of exercise. You come to a Pentecostal church. Amen. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Amen. Raise your hands. You can do jumping jacks. You can run. Do whatever you want to do. Amen. As long as you're praising the Lord, praise God. We want to keep everything in decency and order. And if the Holy Ghost is involved, how many knows it's decent and in order? Amen. Praise God. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here this morning. We got a few announcements we want to make before we get into the service. One of them being that we'll be celebrating communion this afternoon. Come back to service this evening, please, and join in that very special service. Let me know that we commune with the Lord daily. Amen. But when we come together and do a literal communion, I mean, it's just a very strong reminder of God's presence in our life. Amen. Not just at that particular moment, but how many knows God's supposed to be present in our life day in and day out? Amen. When you go home Sunday afternoon after this service, amen, the presence of the Lord ought to go with you. When you go to work on Monday morning, the presence of the Lord ought to be with you. Amen. You ought to be communing, amen, spiritually fellowshipping with Jesus, amen, all the time. That's what communion's really all about. So come back this evening. We'll be doing that. For those that are able and you can, the Poyen High School Chain Gang, we're needing help. Next home game will be this coming Friday. The Indians will host Bigelow, and all gang members will get into the game free. If you're, I just love that, you're a gang member. Anybody else find the humor in that? You're a gang member. I think that's so cool. You can come to Poyen and you get to be a member of a gang. All right. But anyway, if you're a gang member, you get to be you get free admission, and also they'll give you a hot dog. See Pastor Mike if you're interested in doing that. We're going to have a water baptism service coming up on Sunday, October the 30th. For anyone interested in being baptized, there'll be a mandatory baptism class on Sunday, October the 23rd at 9:30 a.m. It'll be in the administration lobby. That's in over there across from the conference room. That'll be at 9:30. Please also see Pastor Mike about that as well. It's fall festival time again. How many's been involved in one of our fall festival weekends? Anybody ever had an opportunity to be a part of that? If you have, you know it is huge. Amen. It's big. It's a big undertaking. It takes a lot of people. It takes a lot of work. Amen. And we need volunteers. We need people to sign up. If you can sign up to help run one of the events, one of the games, and whatnot, there's a sign-up place in the foyer in there. I think it's we got a whiteboard or something set up, don't we? You can sign up on that. See Sister Jonna Kratz. She's going to be overseeing that, and she needs a lot of help. And if we don't get volunteers, she says she's going into recruiting mode immediately. So please volunteer and help out as much as you can. Now, this is going to happen on the 31st, and we are, which is a Monday, actually. And that Sunday, which is the 30th, we're going to have a morning service. We will not be having an evening service. So what we have decided to do, what John decided to do, is for anybody that can help set up for the 31st event, just stay after service on that Sunday morning, the 30th, and we'll grill some hot dogs and feed you, and we'll just fellowship, have a good time. But we're going to go ahead and do the setup right after the morning service on the 30th. So whoever can stay and help with that, please do. That'd just be a lot simpler than having everybody come back on an evening where we're not going to have service anyway. So got lots to do. We need Little Debbie cakes. We need candy. If you go to Walmart, you see big bags of candy individually wrapped. We need that. Little Debbie cakes for the cakewalk. We need those things. And again, just see Sister John if you need, if you have questions on how you can help or what areas we need help in. Amen. I have here a invitation. This is extended to everybody at Poyen. Amen. This is we tried to get it in the bulletin and didn't manage to get it in the bulletin. So this is your official invitation. This is your official notice. Amen. That Sister April has put up with Gary Don Edwards for 50 years now. Come on, somebody. She is a saint. I'm telling you now. She's got a free pass into heaven already just for putting up with this guy for 50 years. No, we love them very much. Listen, this is going to happen next Saturday on October the 15th. It'll be from 2 to 4 p.m. They said, please don't, no gifts or anything like that is expected, but please come by and help them celebrate 50 years of marriage. Amen. That is so rare these days. I want to applaud them again. A lot of people don't make it 50 days, much less 50 years, so that's quite an accomplishment. Liz is going to be at their daughter's home. 6059 Castle Rock Drive. If you need information or directions on that, see Sister April, see Brother Gary Don. They'll get you guided in on that. Again, it's going to be next Saturday from 2 to 4. Please come by and help them celebrate 50 years of wedding. Amen. We are praying this week for the Traskwood Missionary Baptist Church, Reverend Bob Barnett, the state of Qatar in the Middle East, and the missionaries Mike and Dee Loughton, I think I'm saying that right, in Northern Asia. Will you stand to your feet this morning? Pray with me out loud. Come on, I need to get you guys fired up. Y'all not near fired enough up yet for me. I need to get you really fired up, and I can't think of a better way to do that than to just pray, amen, this morning corporately. Let's pray together out loud, amen. How many knows when you pray out loud, somebody next to you is going to get blessed, amen? Shannon, it's so good to see you this morning. Good to have you here. Somebody beside you will get blessed. Amen. I love to hear Matt Vines pray. Even all the way up here, I hear that guy praying down there. Amen. And it just, you want to know why I go so long? It's his fault. He gets me fired up. Amen. So pray out loud. Amen. Let's believe that God's going to bless these other ministries. How many knows when you pray for other ministries, God will bless you? Amen. That's how it works. Praise God. You pray for other people and God will bless you. Amen. Let's pray for God to meet these other needs. We're going to be praying for Israel and for our own service this morning here as well. Lift your voices up with me right now. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much, God, for your presence. Lord, we thank you so much for your intervening, God, in our lives. We thank you so much, Lord, that you are an ever-present help in our time of need. God, we're asking this morning for your special blessing and your favor upon the Traskwood Missionary Baptist Church, Lord, and Reverend Bob Barnett. God, asking for supernatural wisdom, Lord, for knowledge and understanding today, God. We're asking for vision, Lord, that you would just cast your vision, Lord, to them, Lord, and have them, help them, God, empower them, enable them, encourage them, Lord, to carry out that vision, Lord. God, that souls would be saved, Lord, that bodies would be healed in their midst, God. We know this is your kingdom, God. We know this is your purpose for your kingdom, God. That lives be saved, Lord, hearts be saved, Lord. Lord, that families be touched and restored. God, we're asking that for the Traskwood Missionary Baptist Church this morning. Asking for your favor and your blessings upon them, Lord. Asking, Lord God, for your hand to be extended to the state of Qatar in the Middle East, Lord. Lord, knowing that there's much opposition in that part of the world. God, we need you, Lord. We need your mighty touch, Lord. We need your mighty presence, God. We need your spirit in the state of Qatar, Lord. God, that you are blessing them, Lord, that you're anointing them, God. Lord, that you're raising them up for such an hour, such a time as this, God. Lord, that needs are being met in that part of the world, God. Lord, that you are a deliverer, God. Lord, that you're a healer, Lord. Lord, God, that you are all things to all men, Lord. Lord, that you meet every need according to your perfect will. Thank you so much, Jesus. Lord, we lift up today the missionaries, Mike and Dee Loughton, Lord. Lord, asking for your anointing, asking, Lord, that you make provision for them financially, physically, spiritually, emotionally, God. Lord, in every way, Lord, every person that you send their way, God, help their needs to be met, Lord. Give them a double portion, Lord. Pour out upon them your spirit today, God. Thank you so much, Lord. Lord, today we lift up to the nation of Israel, God, asking, Lord, that you bless them. Asking, Lord, that you touch them, God. Lord, that you open their eyes, that they see you, Jesus, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, God. Lord, we bless them in accordance to your word, Lord, in obedience today. And thank you for what you're doing. Come on, church. Help me welcome him in this service this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being in this house. Lord, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your spirit. Thank you, God, for meeting every need and touching each and every one of our lives. As only you can do it, in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, somebody, give him a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Turn to two or three people real close to you. Hug their neck, shake their hand, let them know you're happy to see them in the house of the Lord this morning. If you would, please find your seats, and we get our ushers to please take their place. Amen, amen. Praise God. How many knows this is the day that the Lord has made? Amen. Amen. The psalmist said, I will rejoice. Amen. I will be glad in it. Sometimes you just got to take your old flesh and grab it by the nape of the neck. Amen. And just stand it up and say, I don't care if you don't feel like it. I will be glad. Amen. I will, praise God, praise Him. I will praise Him with my mouth. Amen. All my days. Praise God. I feel like praising the Lord this morning. I want somebody to get with me today. Our praise begins in our giving. How many knows that? Come on, church. It's time to take up the offering this morning. It's time to be a blessing. Amen. We all love to be blessed. We all love for God to give us favor and blessing in our lives. And He does that. He's faithful to do that. How many knows? How many will agree with me this morning? God is faithful. Amen. How many agree? We ought to be faithful. Amen. And I just love the opportunity that we have to give back to the Lord. Pray with me this morning as we take up the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love, God. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings. Lord, we thank you, God, for your provision in our life. Lord, we thank you, God, that every good and perfect gift comes down from you, Lord. You are the Father of life. Lord, there is no variableness with you, God. There is no shadow of turning. Lord, you are steadfast, God, and we love you today, and we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give back into your kingdom. Lord, and we do that today with gladness. We ask that you bless it, press it down, shake it together, cause it to run over. Lord, for the goodness and the advancement of your kingdom, in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Would you please give this morning? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. While the offering's getting taken up, I'm going to ask our pastors to come up. Pastor Mike, Sister Andrea, come up, please. Praise the Lord. Be a pastor, they said. It'll be fun, they said. Praise God. If you're not aware of it, October is Clergy Appreciation Month. Amen? And we want to honor and let our pastors know how much we love and appreciate them. I wonder if all over this house you would stand up, give them an ovation, and let them know how much you love them, appreciate them. All right, that's enough. That's enough. You can sit down. Praise God. This is totally a surprise for them. They don't know at all what's going on. And we are in such a wonderful place to have such wonderful pastors. I'm speaking from my own experience. I have been around the block, amen, a time or two in regard to churches and pastors and men and women of God that I've sat under. And I can honestly tell you there is nobody more wonderful than this couple right here than I have ever served under. And I appreciate their leadership. I appreciate their devotion to this church and to this church body and their service. It's untiring. I'm not saying that they don't get tired, but I'm telling you, they just put forth the effort. They just overcome all of the obstacles. I mean, if you're not ever been in a position of a pastor, you probably can't appreciate this as much as some others who have been in that area can. Being a pastor is hard, and you got to be thick-skinned sometimes, and you got to love on one another when it seems like everybody else is against you. And I just want this couple to know how much we appreciate. And I have never been more appreciative of a pastor and his wife than I am of these guys right here. And I love them so much. So with that being said, church, I want you to know now that you have given and that you will be giving to what we are about to present them with. And what we are about to present them with is a 10-day trip to the Holy Land. Yeah. I don't know how many of you remember when Pastor Ed Huey was here a couple months back, two or three months back, and he made mention of this trip that they were going on, and he even kind of threw a little softball out for us to hit and said, I sure would be nice, he said, if you could maybe send your pastors on this. And so we bit, amen, we swung, we knocked it out of the park, and we have come up with, or are coming up with, amen, the funds to do this. And so here's the thing, it'll be early spring, they'll be going early spring in March sometime, I think it is, over to the Holy Land. I'll be spending 10 days over there. And so if you want to be a part of this major blessing in their life, I want to invite you to please see our church administrator, Sister Kathy Hull. And you can give towards this if you'd like to. They're going. We're going to cover it. But if you want to be a blessing and give to this, you certainly are welcome to do that. And so we want to give you opportunity to see Sister Kathy and donate towards the giving of this. But pastors, we want to present to you this gift in love and appreciation so much of all that you have done and all that you do. God bless you, and we love you so much. Now it's time to get your praise on. Would you stand to your feet?
All right. Praise the Lord. Thank you all so much. Before we get into worship, I want us to do something real quick. If you'll bring up that scripture for me, I want to read something in Psalms 34. It says, I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praise. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come and let us tell the Lord of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I pray to the Lord.
Deliverance
this morning, grab a hold of it in the name of Jesus and get that. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. The devil is defeated in this house this morning. Oh, hallelujah.
I'm
stuff down. Let's put it where it belongs, back in the devil's hands. It didn't belong in our hands. We are forgiven. We are redeemed. We are set free by the blood of Jesus Christ, who washes away everything. He does not condemn us. He woos us. He loves us this morning. And he knows what's best for you, and that's what he wants for your life today. Let's ask God to make us what we need to be so that we can have the joy of the Lord all the time. That we can have the peace of mind that comes from the Lord all the time. That we can have everything that he has to offer for us this morning.
Until you are my one true love. Until making me. Lord Jesus, thank you for never giving up on us. Thank you for continually, Lord, to work on us and to move on our lives. He never gives up on us. This morning, He is here. Just get lost in His presence. Let Him do a ministry in you this morning that only He can do.
Consider for a moment that place we're wanting to be is right in His presence. It's at that place where the supernatural and the natural come together. And I will tell you, at that line we stand at right now, that line we're at right now in worship, that when the natural and the supernatural meet, the supernatural always wins. It'll always win as long as you let Him. Would you let Him today? Would you let Him totally take control of whatever it is that's going on in your life, whatever you're dealing with? Would you just let God have control today? That, Father, we lay before You right now every pain, every grief, every worry, every doubt, every issue, Lord God, that we wrestle with. Father, we lay it at Your feet right now. We need the supernatural to overcome the natural. That, God, we've got a hitch in our body. We've got a sickness that needs to be healed. And I thank You for doctors and nurses and medicine. But, Lord, there's some things that only the blood of Jesus can take care of. So we're needing a supernatural miracle in our body. That, Lord, there are things that counselors cannot touch and that medicines cannot touch. We need a healing in our heart and in our mind, and deliverance, Lord God, from the thoughts that hinder us. That, Father, we cannot wave a wand and make money appear. That, Father, I'm thankful for the story where the disciple caught a fish and opened his mouth and found money. But, God, I have not found money in a fish. But, Lord, You are all sufficient to meet my need, Lord God. And so we allow the supernatural to come in, Lord God, and provide where the natural cannot. That above all, Lord God, we deal with our guilt and we deal with our pain. And Father, we try to self-medicate to get rid of our shame and our doubts. We try to self-medicate, Lord God, to try to make ourselves feel better. And Father, we'll put this in our life and that in our life. We'll drink that. We'll smoke that. We'll go there. We'll lay with that person. But Father, in the end, all it does is build the loneliness and the shame and the regret. And what we need is a supernatural God to wrap his arms of love around us and let us know today that we are loved. We are loved. We are loved beyond our failures. Hallelujah. So God, as we have given you the very best of our tithe and offering already, and we have given you the very best of our worship, I pray already, we give you the very best of all of our problems. And we tell you, Lord, they're yours. And I will worship you with my trust. I will worship you, Lord God, with my belief that you still are a mighty, supernatural God. And Father, we just give you the glory, the praise, and the honor right now. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Come on now, we are a church that believes in the sign and the wonder. We are a church that believes, according to the Word of God, that the gifts are still today. They're still for us today. This word and interpretation that comes to us is saying somebody, God's stopping everything to say somebody has a need today, and this is your moment to get it filled. I'm going to ask if that's you. If that's you and you need something from God today, God's stopping everything for you. Would you come right now? Just stand in an aisle. Just stand in an aisle right there. You don't have to come down to the front. Just stand in an aisle right now. Just find a place. Just get somewhere.
And I'm going to ask, I need my prayer. I need my altar workers. I need my advisory team. I want my staff. Come on. Let's gather around these and let's go from person to person. The Lord lays somebody on your heart. Come on, step out of your chair and come and gather around these right now. There's something in their life that they're needing, and God has stopped everything for them. Would you join with us right now? And let's gather around these and let God move on their need. Let's gather around these. Come on. Father God, right now in the name of Jesus, right now in the name of Jesus, we have such need of you that, God, we lay before you these needs. There are these right here that need a touch from you. They need something in their bodies, Lord God. They need something in their minds. There's a thing that they're dealing with, and you have given them a word of confidence, Lord God. It is a true word, and that, Father, this word is that if they come to you, that, Lord God, you will meet them. You will meet their need. You will deliver them. You will be their God. You will cause them to have a better day, a better life. You will take that burden and make it your own. So, Father God, right now in Jesus' name, Lord, we bring these needs to you and lay them at your feet. And, Father God, I pray right now, take every man, take every woman, that, Lord God, you would bless them. And God, let there be peace. Satan, we bind you right now in the name of Jesus. You have no authority whatsoever. You have no authority whatsoever to interfere in these people's lives. And Father God, we pray right now, do a miracle. Lord God, let a miracle be found in the house. Let a miracle be found in the house, Lord God. In every one of them, whatever their need is, God, you see it. You see what it is that they deal with. And God, we're going to give it to you right now. And believe, Lord, we believe. Help our unbelief, Lord God. We believe for you to move right now. We believe for you to move right now. Hallelujah. 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 Yes. Oh. Oh, no place long. We want to be as an ungrateful people. One who demands God to move because we demand Him to move. Our God moves on us out of the generosity of His Spirit, out of the love of His heart, not that we deserve anything. So, as grateful people, what do we need to do? Would you join me right now and let's tell the Lord thank you for being in our midst. Thank you, God, for touching hearts. Thank you, Lord God, for things that you're doing. God, I believe there's things you've already accomplished, but Lord, I also believe that as people leave here today, you're going to keep moving and keep working and keep doing. That very word is inside of them. He who began a good work in you, he began a good work today, and he's going to be faithful, faithful, faithful to complete it. God, I thank you. God, I thank you. God, I thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Grateful for God who engages all of our senses. He allows us to worship him in more than just that's because that's what we do. Our worship our worship blesses his heart. And what does a loving father do when his heart is full? His heart overflows onto us. Can I tell you, we are in that sweet spot where the overflow of the Father's heart is bathing us in this moment. Those of you that can be seated. Those of you who cannot, then don't. Hallelujah. Whew. We serve an outstanding God. And we get to serve him with some outstanding people. Come on, reach over next to you. Grab somebody's hand or their knee, give them a squeeze. Tell them you're glad you got to see them today. Man, I tell you, I love being in the presence of God, but I love being in the presence of God with God's people. I want to encourage you, be a people that look for every occasion to get together with God's people. Come on, we're not in a boring church. Some of you that are in here and you didn't grow up in a Spirit-filled Pentecostal fashion are looking at all this like this is some kind of strange. You ask them, this is not boring. It's not normal, but it's not boring. Just wait till we get the snakes out. Hallelujah. No, we don't do that. We don't do that. I had somebody ask me this week, where do y'all keep the snakes? I said, it's under the platform. Yeah. No, we don't have snakes in this place. But I am grateful. I am blessed. You are blessed by God who's willing to interrupt everything week after week after week. I don't understand why somebody wouldn't want to be in a place where God shows up and moves. That's where I want to be. Because I'm telling you, I get blessed every week. Every week. And I am grateful
to pastor the best church I've ever pastored in my life. And I don't say that lightly, because I pastored a couple great churches. There was one that wasn't so great. That's okay. I'll take that one, but I love being here, and I love you. And again, thank you for blessing us. And I will tell you that this is Pastor Appreciation Month. Some of you saw the text or the Facebook post on our church Facebook page that I put out there. We don't just have one pastor. We have a lot of pastors in this church. And I'm going to ask you to bless all of those pastors, because I will tell you, as a lead pastor, I can't get the job done if I don't have these people around me. In the spring, back in about April or May, we honored all of our directors who handle all of our works ministries. In October is where we bless those who work in the word ministries, who do the teaching and the preaching. And so I want to ask you, please, go out of your way to write a card, get a little gift card, something. Shake their hand, hug their neck, tell them that you love them. Because a lot of these people, they do it out of the kindness of their heart. They do it, they are volunteering their labors day in and day out for you. And they take things. I'm telling you, if you've never been in the ministry before, you don't understand that sometimes there is a negative underbelly to ministry. Not everybody you help is grateful that you helped. And so I want you to be sure and not only hug and love on them, but you need to tell their spouses how much you appreciate them. Because behind every successful pastor is, first of all, a very surprised mother-in-law. Hallelujah. But there is a special spouse that not only puts up with them, but they try to help them make ministry happen. I could not get the work done as a pastor if it wasn't for my wife. I know my other pastors would join that sentiment, is that the only way they can get the job done is by having to help meet with them. So be sure, please, 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 honor and love those that serve you, as the Bible says, and because it makes us want to become better pastors for you. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter number 22. And I want to share with you message dealing with God's best gifts, the best gifts that the Lord ever gave. I want to encourage you, we're going to have the end of this month. The last Sunday of this month is our fifth Sunday, as Pastor Ed was saying. Fifth Sundays, we don't do anything. We have service that morning, and then we take Sunday evening to be family time. Go, if a church is having a singing, go to their singing. If they're having a revival, go to their revival. Go be blessed. Otherwise, go be with your family and spend some time with your family. We are going to be setting up for our Halloween alternative, our fall festival, that day. But it's a special day because we are going to be baptizing people. And I'm excited. Man, I'm excited seeing people get baptized. Had another just made a comment. She wants to get baptized as well. So we've got three or four already that are wanting to be baptized. If that's you, you need to come see myself or see Pastor Ed, and we want to make that available to you. But we're also going to do something else, as we're kind of combining a lot of things on that one special day, and that is this. I want you to invite a friend to church that day. Does anybody have a friend? Anybody got friends? I'm just curious about that. If you have a friend, invite them to church. Pastor, my friends go to another church. That's all right. If they go to another church, that's fine. I want us to be intentional to invite those that don't go to church anywhere. Listen, I'm grateful for pastoring a church that grows, a church that moves, a church that does things. But I don't want to be guilty of being a pastor that takes other people's people. I want to reach out to the lost. You heard me say this the other day, that in 2017, the census that is projected for just Grant County, just this area, lists at least 3,000 people that do not claim Jesus Christ as their Lord right here within a 10-mile radius of this church. 3,000 people. We have 15,000 people within a 10-mile radius of this church. 3,000 of them do not claim to be a Christian, go to church anywhere. That's not including those that say, well, I'm of this church, and they haven't been to church in 20 years.
but at least 3,000 don't go to church anywhere. Let's reach them. You want me to reach 3,000 people? Well, if you got that means, you go right ahead. I'm asking you to reach one. One. And this last Sunday of the month on the 30th, I'm going to ask you to be a church that does their two-part process. What is that? Number one, to know him. And secondly, that is who we are. That's what we do. That's how we move as a church, to know God and then to make him known. In the book of Ezekiel, chapter 22, I got to get my reading glasses out, because I have gotten to that age. Hallelujah. In Ezekiel, chapter 22, starting in verse number 23, would you stand with me? Used to do that a long time ago. I appreciate when the brother from Davis Creek, Brother Jackson, when he preached the other day, I was grateful for people who stood out of honor of God's word. I'm telling you, when you honor God, God will make sure you get honored. Verse 23 says, again, a message came to me from the Lord. Stop right there a second. I'm the only pastor that's going to bless you with coffee and fudge. No other pastor tells you to do that. I'm going to ask you to get some coffee and fudge and go over verse 23. And a message came to me from where? Do you know that God still wants to speak to you? And that God, if you'll listen, has a message for you, but he also has a message he'll give you for somebody else. That's part of that making him known, is take the word he gives us and then share it. Verse 24, son of man, give the people of Israel this message. In the day of my indignation, you will be like a polluted land, a land without rain. Your princes plot conspiracies just as lions stalk their prey. They devour innocent people, seizing treasures and extorting wealth. They make many widows in the land. Your priests have violated my instructions and defiled my holy things. They make no distinction between what is holy and what is not. And they do not teach my people the difference between what is ceremonially clean and unclean. They disregard my Sabbath day so that I am dishonored among them. And then your leaders are like wolves who tear apart their victims. They actually destroy people's lives for money. And your prophets cover up for them by announcing false visions and making lying predictions. They say, my message is from the sovereign Lord, when the Lord hasn't spoken a single word to them. Have you getting the idea? This is a little bit of a negative word right here. Verse 29, even common people oppress the poor, rob the needy, and deprive foreigners of justice. I, the Lord, looked for someone who might rebuild the walls of righteousness that guards the land. I searched for someone to stand in the gap. Yes. But I found no one. So now I will pour out my fury on them, consuming them with the fire of my anger. I will heap on their heads the full penalty for all their sins. And I, the sovereign Lord, have spoken. You may be seated. Have you ever been a part of something unhealthy? An unhealthy family? An unhealthy workplace? Have you ever been in an unhealthy church? I'll tell you, if you can say yes to one of those things, you can identify with the fact that nobody is enriched by such an experience as that. Nobody is blessed to be a part of something that's unhealthy, but especially God. If God's house is not healthy, God suffers because it's his church. When God's people are behaving in an unhealthy manner, it hurts God. Because he's the father. Come on, your children ever misbehaved and that didn't crawl all over you? Your children never said or did anything that made you turn red in shame, ready to kick them to the curb and donate them out to somebody? I heard somebody one time, believe it or not, I have watched Gaither videos, And on one of those Gaither videos, there's one of the singers stood up and said, "Me and my wife believe in adoption. And we've adopted 2 out of 3 kids. And if we could ever get rid of that last one, we'll have adopted out all of it." Some of y'all get that later. We hurt when we're in an unhealthy circumstance, but I will tell you, God is hurt in an unhealthy circumstance. And what you are reading right there from the text is literally the word of a broken-hearted Savior. I was writing an article one time for a post, and it was dealing with a pastor in a church somewhere around Michigan, somewhere up north. And as the choir had sang and the choir was coming down out of the choir loft, there was the pastor's wife down here, and the pastor's wife knew that her husband was having an affair on her and that the mistress was in the choir. And so as the choir is coming down from singing their song, the pastor's wife decides to confront the mistress coming out of the choir loft, and they go after it, and pretty soon hair is flying, fists are waving, and what started off as what we would call a cat fight between two ladies turns into a church brawl. And finally, the leadership of the church, in the midst of all this pandemonium that's breaking out, starts looking for the pastor to calm everything down, and they look everywhere, and the pastor's left the building. He got in his car and left, because there is no good outcome for him in this. Even though stuff like that shouldn't be, and there's no need for it. This is a fitting description of Ezekiel's day. This is the kind of thing of an adulterous people who are cheating on the heart of their Savior. That's what you read there. You're reading the broken heart of a bridegroom who's been rejected. And Ezekiel's ministry was around 593 to 573 BC. It was a 20-year span. Those of you that read the book of Jeremiah was a contemporary of Ezekiel. They were there at the same time, writing their books and prophesying their messages at the same time. Ezekiel was trained to be a priest in all of this atmosphere that I've described for you. He's a priest in this day in that church, and he's just starting out his ministry. He's not an older man. When it talks about how the word came on him in his 30th year, you have to understand in the culture of the Jewish person, a man is not a man until he's 30 years old. We like to brag, Matt, when we're 18, I'm a man. I'm a man. I can boat. I can walk around without my shirt on. No, you need to put that shirt back on. Goodness. I'm a man. You're not a man in the Jewish culture until you're 30. And here at 30, he's saying, I've just now started. That is, it's no coincidence that at the age of 30, at that point, he becomes a respected man in his community. It says that the word of the Lord came to him, that the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Now, many Jews had already been deported. Babylon has come and has conquered and is still conquering parts of Israel. They've sacked Jerusalem. They grab the people, put them in chains, and march them back to Babylon, to the land of Chaldea. They march them out as slaves, no longer to live in freedom in their own country. And so this is what has happened. The people are paying the price for their crimes against God. And as they've been marched off, eventually Ezekiel, he's there, but eventually Ezekiel will wind up in Babylon with them, living in a camp on the outskirts of Babylon, just outside the city, with a bunch of displaced Jews that can no longer go back to their homeland. They're stuck in a foreign land. And the main course of his ministry that he would spend his life doing is to a banished people. He would die in a place of judgment. You mean God would judge the church? Do you remember back in the Bible where it says, those things that can be shaken shall be shaken from within? All judgment starts where? In the house of the Lord. And you have to understand there are people who love God and were faithful to God, and yet they got marched out to Babylon. Why? Because they are in the midst of the fallen people. We are with them. And he would spend the rest of his days explaining to these people, here's why you're in Babylon. Here's why your children were killed. Here's why your wife is taken from you and is now a prostitute inside the city. Here's why you have lost everything. I mean, it was a horrible situation. And he would sit there and spend his days explaining it to them. And being new in ministry, he's been trained under fallen men. His sense of religious duty was now overwhelmed by living God instead of a dead religion. He's trained by men how to be bad. That's what the word says. It says that these men spoke evil things. They gave false prophecies. He's trained by these very people that God is judging. But now a living God comes on him and says, I've got something to say and I need you to say it for me. Man, he was ecstatic. He was enthusiastic. In chapter 11, you don't have to look there, but in chapter 11, he makes his statement, the Spirit of the Lord fell on me. That term, fell on me, is like having a favorite coat. Having a coat that, I mean, it fits right, it smells right, it's all soft, and man, it just makes you warm instantly. It's like on it being so cold, and immediately that coat is placed on you, and everything is now just right, and everything is good. The Spirit of the Lord, what? It fell on me. It wrapped itself around me. He would also say, the Spirit took me up and brought me in a vision by the Spirit of God into Chaldea, into the land of captivity, to those in captivity. He was in Israel, but he had an out-of-body experience from where he was at. Can you imagine that? Man, you right here in Poyen, and all of a sudden you're somewhere else. That's because you are. Wake up. Come on. Nudge your neighbor. Tell him to focus on the pastor here. Man, he had an out-of-body experience. Went totally somewhere else. How can you adequately describe, especially when you haven't been trained for this, how do you adequately describe what the Spirit is saying to you, what he's showing to you? Man, I look at these Old Testament prophets and I try to imagine, how would they explain an airplane? How would they describe something they don't know about? And I looked up and I beheld a great metal bird with wheels like chariots upon his feet. That's crazy. And he roars as he flies, but he never flaps his wings. And as he lands upon the ground, people from all over the world crawl into his mouth and they lay within its belly. And with a roar, the bird, without flapping its wings, flies into the air. Come on, some of you got to have some imagination, man. You just got to have some imagination. Hey, I'm feeling good today. My Aggies won. The Hogs did good. Come on, somebody. They played Alabama better than anybody else. We're just going to pray that the evil shall fall in its day. Alabama shall hit the... Okay, that's another sermon for another time. This great bird lands on the ground and then it vomits the people. Come on, like Jonah. You remember that? Vomits the people out of its mouth. How do you describe that sort of stuff? How do you describe what God is doing to you? How do you describe the vision God is giving you that somebody else can get it? There's a story that comes from the era of the Great Depression. Talked about a 7-year-old boy who tasted a soda for the very first time. He never had a soda before. Somebody gets him a little bit of soda, and he drinks it, and all of his friends are watching him. His family's with him, and he drinks that. And they ask him, said, what did it taste like? What was it like? Because they never had it either. What was it like? Describe it to us. And he said, 7 years old, as only a 7-year-old could describe it, it tastes like your feet fell asleep. Tastes like your feet fell asleep. How many of you understand that? You got that fizzy and tingly sensation like what? Like your foot went to sleep. Man, my mouth went to sleep. Tastes like grapes, but my mouth went to sleep. How do you describe what God is doing? But can I tell you, even when we find it hard to describe, if it's God, people are going to understand. The people of God are going to understand what you're saying. And it's going to mesh with them just like it meshed with you. What we know is that in spite of a church that was dead in that day, in spite of a government that was corrupt, and in spite of a generation that had forgotten God, God still found one man who would listen to him. Why is that important? Because God was still in the reaching business. Think about this. His people desert him. His people don't want him. His people are rejecting him. They're making up lies. They're saying how bad God is and how good the world is. Sounds a little bit like today, doesn't it? And it says that the Lord said, I looked in the breaches. I looked on the wall. I looked for one man. If one man, come on somebody, if one man will take a stand, if one woman will take a stand, I will. Don't have to judge. Can one person make a difference? I will tell you, yes, they can. Students, you can make a difference in your school. Mom and dad, you can make a difference in your family. You can make a difference in your workplace. Why, I hate my job. The most hellish people work here. Quit looking at it as suffering and look at it as your mission field. God is still in the reaching business. He still wants to give grace. And as God is dealing with this aftermath of a fallen people, he deals with a demoralized group who is full of their shame. As Ezekiel speaks to them, boy, they just want to cover their head. They're realizing for the first time how bad they were. You ever been there? How bad they were and how they shouldn't have done what they did. In chapter 22, there speaks of four different people groups: the prophets, the priests, the princes, and the people. The prophets, the priests, the princes, and the people. And each, his message was, is that each individual, every one of you, me, every one of us individually must personally accept responsibility for our sin, which has now resulted in a national calamity. He speaks first of all to the prophets. The prophet is the people who hear the mind of God, and they make what is going on in God's mind, they make that known to those that are around them. The prophets who are able, where the Bible says, the Lord says, I do nothing except I first tell my people, the prophets. Do you understand if God's up to something? He's telling somebody if somebody's listening. If somebody will say, here I am, Lord, speak to me. God is looking for somebody because his word says, I don't do anything until I first tell my people, the prophets. Why does he tell the prophets? So the prophets can then tell the people, here's what God is up to. Listen to me, in a day and age where we take the prophet and the apostle and we throw them out the door, I'm telling you, the fivefold ministry is still happening today to those who let it. And the prophets, who should know the mind of God and make it known, instead begin to deceive and manipulate people for their own purposes. God said this, and God didn't say a word. God told you to do this thing and you didn't do it. Why were they saying these things? Because they wanted things for themselves. The prophet and the priest, who are supposed to live a life subjected, a life that is, I live for God and not for my own pleasure. But they see what everybody else is getting. They see what everybody else is doing. And they start saying, man, I want some of that. Have you ever looked at the unrighteous people and it looks like they get blessed every time they turn around? Those that don't love God, they're not trying to serve God, and yet it seems like they get and get and get. And it's tempting for us as Christians to say, why can't God do that for me? Friend, let me tell you something. The only heaven they're ever going to get is right here in this world. We have a home that the Bible says rust cannot destroy, the moth cannot eat up, the thief cannot steal. We are storing up treasures where? In heaven. Listen, this life passes away. You'll come to the end of your days, and as you're lying there in a bedroom or in a nursing home, all of your possessions that you have ever had can now be put in one box. All of your stuff is gone. So we don't bank on what we get here. It's what we know we're going to get there. Come on, somebody. Are you with me here? And they began to manipulate people. The prophets did, because they wanted their own things. Well, now the priests were no different. The priests, their whole sole ambition for life is supposed to be to teach the people of God God's word in order to make them spiritually healthy. The prophets tell the people what God is doing. The teachers, the pastors, they're the ones that are supposed to take God's word and lead them in that direction. Teaching them to be a people. Here's how to please God. Here's how to serve God. Here's what God wants and desires. And yet, they not only refused to hold the prophets accountable, say, quit your lying, shut your mouth if you can't talk right. They didn't do it. As a matter of fact, they not only didn't correct the prophet, but they became just as bad, deceiving and manipulating for their own gain as well. Getting and getting and getting and getting. Why? Because I'm selfish. I want. Listen, man, selfishness is not going to get you anywhere. So I was sharing Wednesday night. We're in a study right now called The Autopsy of a Deceased Church. We're looking at how to have a healthy church. Man, I'm not going to be foolish enough to think the good things God's doing at Poyen Assembly is something God's just always going to do. Do you understand? You can't have good church on accident. Just like you can't eat yesterday's lunch and think you're going to be okay today. Do you hear me? Good church happens because we aim for it. And we live a life pleasing to God because we aim for it. Here you've got a group of people that are so unselfish that it's ruining them. They're so selfish, it's ruining them spiritually. I want, I want, I want. And it's coming between them and God. Because you have to understand, God desires to be your provider. Go back and reread where Jesus said, if you want me and you want heaven, you're going to have to come as a little child. Go back and re-understand what Christ was saying there. That we have to be a people who, though we can make it on our own, says, God, I still need your help. God, without you, I can't make it. Without you, I've got nothing. I've got nothing. He shifts gears after he gets onto the prophet and he gets onto the priest. Then he aims for the princes. The prophet and the priest, they lead the land spiritually, but you have the princes of the land who lead the land with the law and justice. And they are to use the teachings and the leadings of the church in order to lead the nation in power and justice. They're supposed to, because remember, with God, it's not church and state. It's all one in Him. We do not practice in God a democracy. You need to understand that. As we go and we vote, and please make sure you get a voter's guide and pray, please, dear God, pray before you get in that voting booth. With God, there is no Democrat or Republican. With God, there is no Democratic Republic. With God, there's a thing called a theocracy. What is that? It means God is in charge. God is on the throne. God rules all, and His law is what we live by. That is actually what America was founded on. But I'm afraid she is not today. The princes of the land were to take the things that they learned from the prophet and the priest and put it into the public. And can I tell you, that's exactly what they were doing, unfortunately. Because they refused to address the church's failing. And in itself, they became corrupt and abusive, just like they saw happening in the church. And they used the law to call the good things bad and the bad things good. Sounds a lot like today, don't it? And lastly, he dealt with the people. And the people, if you had any power, if you had any ability, if you had anything, because there will always be the poor among you, as Jesus said. If we have it within us to help somebody else, but we don't, that thing is a sin. That's exactly what he's talking about here. And he said, the people learned corruption from those that are over them. They learn corruption in the church. They learn corruption in the state capitol. They learn corruption from both sides. And let me tell you, if the leadership's going to be corrupt, so goes the people. And the people began to oppress and abuse those that are around them. The truest thing in Ezekiel's day that could be said at this moment was the same thing that was said about Israel 500 years earlier at the end of the book of Judges, where it makes one sentence. It says this: in those days, everyone did what was right in their own eyes. God help us. God help us. By rights and by a standard of righteousness, Israel needed to be punished. Have you know, your kids can act the fool, but eventually you're going to have to be the parent, and you're going to have to get hold of your child. Let me say that again. I thought I was in the South here where we still whoop our kids. If your kids are going to act up and you really love your children, you will discipline your child. I don't want to discipline my kid because I want my child to like me. Your child doesn't need to like you. They need to respect you. Because the heart of a child is made to love, but a child loves correction. They need correction. Watch a child that, come on somebody, watch a child that gets corrected and you're going to see love spring in their heart. But you watch a child that is not corrected and they're allowed to run loose like a feral dog. And I'll tell you, that child will be filled with anger. It'll be filled with hatred and it'll unleash itself on anybody that it can. An amazing thing that if you discipline a child, that child loves. Yeah. By rights, Israel needed to be punished. And this is what gets me. Even in the throes of her sin, God still wanted to show mercy. He still wanted to show mercy. Verse 30. And I looked for someone who might rebuild the wall of righteousness that guards the land. That wall that guards. That wall that keeps. That wall that protects. It's a wall of righteousness. He said, it's down. It's broken. And the Lord says, I need it rebuilt. I need it to be rebuilt. I need it to be set up because I want to protect my people from the things that are out there. And I searched for someone to stand in that gap of the wall, that broken spot where righteousness protects and righteousness protects, but somebody let their guard down. Somebody didn't do their job. Somebody was not faithful in the hour. Somebody did not stay in their place. Somebody got scared. Somebody got selfish. Somebody wanted their own way, and they left the wall open. And God said, all I need is one man. All I need is one woman. One person. I don't need the whole army. I don't even need the whole nation. I want my whole nation. But give me one man. Give me one woman filled with my spirit, and I'll show you what I can do with them. But there wasn't one. I just wanted one person to stand in the gap of the wall so I wouldn't have to. Somebody say have to. So I wouldn't have to destroy the land. But I found no one. God has mercy he wants to pour out, but it's only if we desire it. And God desires to bless America, but I ask you, why should he? When America's prophets and priests and princes and people have all denied him. So, because I know I'm making you shout a lot right now, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, John 3:16, that whosoever, come on, that's you and me. That's not red or yellow, black or white. There's no haves and have-nots. There's no this side of the tracks or that side of the tracks. Whosoever. Whoever would call on the name of the Lord shall be what? Saved. God so loved the world that he gave his son as an act of grace. He gave Jesus as a gift of life for the world. Now stay with me, because this gets even better. As Jesus comes into the world, as God's gift to the world, Jesus said, guess what? I got a gift. I got a gift for this world. And so Jesus gave the world the church. And the church was Jesus' gift of hope. It was supposed to be an island of light in the midst of a sea of darkness. Because you go back and reread Matthew 16, 18, and Jesus said, I will build my what? Church. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Oh, Pastor Mike, man, churches ain't what they're supposed to be. You're right, people aren't what they're supposed to be either. Now listen, I'm about to meddle here just a second, so I'll give you a warning. I'm amazed how often people will not want to be in church because churches don't act right. I'll tell you, as a pastor, if I haven't offended you, take a number and wait, because I'm going to do something eventually that rubs you the wrong way. And I apologize right now for it. And if you ever get upset at me, I'm going to ask you to come ask me, or tell me, excuse me, come tell me what it is, and let me make it right. Let me apologize to you, because the spirit I have inside of me is not one of pain, it's one of healing. I do not want to hurt anybody. But I'm telling you, I'll hurt your feelings at some point, because I'm not going to eat your green bean casserole, Trish. I love you, because she brought one the other day. I'll do something that offends you, just like you'll do something that offends me. Well, I don't want to go to church because that church I was at, that church was bad. Man, anybody ever drive a Yugo? You remember that? All it needed was a handle on top, man. It was a lunchbox. That's about all it was good for. It's a terrible car. Terrible. You don't even see them driving around anymore. Man, I see some old stuff that's still on the road, but you don't see a Yugo anymore. Unless one of y'all have one, I apologize right now because I am offending you. But you know, General Motors didn't quit making cars because somebody made a Yugo and it was a failure. And Ford never quit making vehicles because the Yugo was made and it was so terrible. Dodge didn't quit making it. Somebody tracking with me right here. Just because somebody had a bad car doesn't mean the whole car industry went to pot, and yet we're quick to throw away every church in the land because one was unhealthy. Amen. Listen to me. God's gift to the world was Jesus. Jesus turned around and gave a gift to the world, and it's called the church. And Jesus so loved his creation of the church that he gave them God called, Bible equipped, spirit empowered people to become its leadership. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. Now these are the gifts Christ gave the church: the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. And their responsibility is to equip God's people. It's talking about you. To equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. God loved the world. He gave it a gift of Christ. Christ loved the world so much, he gave it a church. And he loved the church so much, he gave it pastors and leaders. And then in the midst of all this love and giving, God gave another gift to his church. And that's you. Do you know you're God's gift to this church? You're the people. In Acts chapter 2, verse 47, it says, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. I want the musicians to come if they would. If for no other reason than just give you hope that this is going to end.
Come on, I've sat where you've sat. The pastor started to preach, and he got up there and he opened up his Bible. Daddy, what does that mean? Why, he's getting ready to read from the Word of God. He looks up towards heaven. Daddy, what's he doing? He's getting the mind of Christ. He mutters a little bit, and he said, Daddy, what is he doing? He's praying for that word he's about to give. He sees him take off the watch and lay it down there. Said, Daddy, what is he doing? Absolutely nothing. So hear this. I know it may seem like I'm preaching to the choir today because you're here and other people are not. I get that. I want you to know I do get that. I'm not a pastor that beats the sheep that show up because the sheep that don't. That's not my heart. Not my heart at all. But I want you to hear the truth from God. The church is God's plan A to reach this world. And there is no plan B. Somebody needs to get that. You can go back in the day of Ezekiel and see that, yes, the church was unhealthy. Yes, bad things were happening. And yes, the world was falling apart. But if the church had been healthy, I'm telling you, it could have turned a lot of things around. And how does the church get healthy? Because its people are healthy. God's plan A to reach this world is you and us together. And if we're not doing this together, listen to me, how's this world going to get reached? Because I will tell you, the majority of churches today in America have zero plans for evangelism. The average church in America, their idea of reaching out to their fellow man is standing at the door on a Sunday morning, holding it open, looking at the traffic as it goes by, and waving at them, hoping somebody will come in. When Jesus said, go out into the highways and the byways and compel my people to come in. Come in where? To my house, that it may be filled. If we want to truly impact our world, and I'm telling you, as a pastor, that's what I want to be. I want to be a pastor that changes my world. I want to be a pastor that if I died tomorrow, it would leave a gaping hole in my community because I stood for God that much in my community. I want to be that man. You need to be that man. You need to be that woman that is so woven into the fabric of the lives of those that are around you through Christ Jesus that it leaves a gaping hole. And if we truly want to impact our world, if we want to make a difference right here from Poyen, right here from Central Arkansas, I'll tell you we can. I want to make a difference so that crime is dropping. I want to make a difference so that families stay together. I want to be a part of a church that's so effective, violence begins to drop all around us. I want to be a church where racial reconciliation is a standard practice. I want to be a church where the lost can walk through those doors and they feel love the moment they come in. I want to be a church where children quit getting pregnant. I want to be a church where people quit being addicted. I want to be a church where wars cease. I want to be a church that changes people's lives. I want to be a church that is a threat to every devil in hell. I want to be a church that changes its culture. And if we want to be that church, we have to act like that church. We can't just say it. We have to act like it. It's got to be in our DNA. It's got to be with us when we leave here and go out there. You can't praise and worship the Lord here, then go to the restaurant and give the cook or the waitress a cussing because they got your food wrong. We have to behave. We have to do right. We have to show love to those we come around.
that when we see somebody we don't know, we smile, we're friendly, that they could see Christ in us without us ever having to say a word. If we're going to be that church, then listen to me. First of all, pastors, if you're a pastor in this church, stand up. If you're a pastor in this church, stand up. I know we got children's pastors that are doing their things. Those of you that are pastors of this church, lead this people righteously. Do you hear me? Lead this people righteously. Be able to say, as Paul said, imitate me as I imitate who? Christ. Lead in such a way. Stay standing. I want all the leaders in this church to stand. If you are a department leader, a ministry leader, if you are an advisor in this church, I want you to stand. Come on, cross this place. Stand. I will tell you, as leadership in this church, support the vision that God gives. Do not be selfish and want a different thing. Follow the way that God is leading. Do as God is directing and help the commission to happen. Because there'll be those that I only have a limited influence to, but there are so many that you come in contact with that I can't. Lead this church right so that God can look at your ministry and your action and say, well done, good and faithful servant. And I want all the people to stand in this place. This is my closing directive to you. You as a people, be faithful according to God's word. You are not trying to make Pastor Mike happy. You are trying to please the heart of your Heavenly Father who sees you at every moment. Live according to His word faithfully and do your own work in the field. If God gives you much, you can turn that around and double it and give God back. Just like the parable of the talents. God gives you a little, you can double that and give it back to God, and God will say, I reward you, good and faithful servant. But we cannot be the one. You cannot be the one that receives from God and then buries it and says, I'm going to go do my own thing. Because church, that'll never work. We have got to be a people that follows after the heart of our Father. We have to pray one for another. Pray for the leaders of your church. Pray for your pastors. Pray for those that are in church with you. Pray for Poyen Assembly of God. Pray for our community. Those of you that live in Poyen, you pray for Poyen. If you live in Prattsville, pray for Prattsville. If you're from Malvern, Sheridan, Leola, Traskwood, Hot Springs, Pine Bluff, wherever you're from, take your community to God. And then take your state to God. Take your nation to God. Take your world. One person can make a difference if we'll be the one that says, God, I'll stand in the gap. Because I want it to be that the next time God says, I look for someone, I want Him to be able to say, I looked for someone until I got to Poyen and I found what I was looking for. Yeah. Father God, right now, we give You us. We give You our lives. We give You our church. We give You its leadership. We give You our community. We give You our state. We give You our nation. We give You our world, Lord God. And God, we pray, move on it. Because You'll judge it if You have to. But You'd rather correct it with some love and some mercy. Lead it into a right path through a loving voice and a merciful touch. But if there's nobody there, then judgment must reign. And God, what I pray is use us. Let us be the people that are willing to know you and make you known wherever we go. That God, we can make a difference for you. Your greatest gifts you ever gave was Christ, the church, its leadership, and its people. We are the gift to the entire world together. Let us be a good gift that people want. Watch over us, Lord. I pray that you would guide and direct our steps. Lead us, Lord God. Lead us in every direction we go for your glory. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're here today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, I will tell you, today is your day. You can know the Lord as your Savior today. Are you here and you'd say, I need the Lord. I need the Lord. Hallelujah. Slip up a hand and put it back down. I want to pray with you today. I need the Lord. Thank you. Is there somebody else? I need the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 With every head bowed. Pastor Mark. Pastor Matt, Brother Matt, would you pray with these gentlemen right behind you right there? Is there somebody else? Is there somebody else ready to receive the Lord today? The greatest thing that could ever happen in your life is to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Is there anybody else? And Father God, I pray right now that the rest of us, we know you. And as we know you, let us know you better. And may you use us to make you known wherever we go. Watch over us. Give us a great rest of our day. Bless us, Father. And God, we give you the glory right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I want you to know that I love you, and I thank God for you, and I ask God's blessings to be on you. Thank you for the privilege of allowing my wife and I to be your pastor. It's a joy to serve with you. Turn to somebody, shake a hand, hug a neck because you love one another. God bless you. We'll see you tonight at 5 o'clock. Come back tonight. We'll be observing communion. Come back and be with us. God bless you.